delighted to be here, and I'd like to make this into a kind of conversation, because that's what we need to do right now. Look, we're all living a very special moment. I think a couple of years from now, you'll think of this as the Occupy moment. And it's been a remarkable experience, because first of all, it's been a world experience. It's spread incredibly, and you have to link it in with an awful lot of other things that have been going on the last year, two, 3 years across the world. A little heavily in North America, Latin America, and Europe a little, and the Arab world a little thinner in Asia, and pretty much in Africa too. But it is. Now, I gave as a title to this talk, Upsurge of Movements Around the World, 1968 Redux, And the answer is, in a word, yes, it's Redux, and no, it isn't Redux. This is obviously the heir of the World Revolution of 1968. It's the continuation of the World Revolution of 1968, but this is 40-odd years later, and the world has moved on, and there are, it is different in some significant way. So what I thought I'd do is start by talking a little about what I think 1968 was all about, and then talk a little bit about what's happened in the world since 1968, and then get us up to where we are today and where we may be headed. I think of 1968 is a symbolic year, but actually what I'm talking about went on from about 1966 to about 1970, and it went on everywhere. It was a world revolution in the very simple sense that in those days, if those of you were old enough to remember those days, we really thought of talking about three worlds. There was the first world, which was sort of the pan-European world, Western Europe, the United States, Australia, and so forth. And then there was the so-called second world, which was the communist world, or the socialist world, whatever you want to call it. And then there was the third world. The third world was Asia and Africa. And we talked in those terms, and we thought in those terms. And one of the remarkable things about 1968, the World Revolution, is it occurred in all three of these worlds, which is something that no one at the time expected sometimes didn't even understand. But it depends, of course, what you include in the World Revolution 1968. I personally, for example, think of the Cultural Revolution in China as part of the World Revolution of 1968. I think of, of course, what went on in Western Europe, we know, in France, in Germany, in Britain, in Italy, and so forth. And of course, in the United States, and I was personally in the middle of the initial big event, which was the Columbia uprising in April of 1968. 1 month, I keep reminding my French friends, that was 1 month before they started things. So we think of them as having copied us, not the other way around. But anyway, what was remarkable about the World Revolution of 1968 was it was a double revolution, or a double set of demands. One was the denunciation of U.S. hegemony in the world system, which was, of course, we were still in the middle of the Vietnam War and so forth. It was a denunciation of U.S. hegemony, and this is very important for everybody who was involved in the World Revolution of the 68, the collusion of the Soviet Union with U.S. hegemony. So when the Chinese, for example, talked about the split, they pictured it as the U.S. and the Soviet Union on one side and everybody else on the other side. It's hard to get your mind around that these days, but that's how it was being focused. And if you look at the analyses across the world, that theme of being against U.S. hegemony and being against Soviet collusion with U.S. hegemony was a very central theme. And the second central theme, we have forgotten, we really have forgotten how strong the anti-systemic movements were in the period 1945 to 68. They suddenly came to power everywhere. What does that mean? Well, it came to power in different forms. We have a third of the world, which is the so-called socialist world, and of course there were communist parties in power, and they had been part of the historic anti-systemic movements. If you look at North America and Western Europe, what you see is that the social democrats were in power, alternating power, but dominating the scene. And I include New Deal Democrats as social democrats. They didn't use the same terminology, but it was the exact same theme. And in the third world, you had the National Liberation Movement. So actually, it was a remarkable situation in which, out of nowhere, really, because as of before the Second World War, you wouldn't have thought they were so strong, they suddenly achieved this objective of coming to power. And what the revolutionaries in 1968 said to all these movements who came to power, the communist movements, social democratic movements, national liberation movements, you promised us that when you came to power, you would transform the world. And you've come to power, and you haven't transformed the world. So there's something wrong there. So this is this double revolt against U.S. hegemony and Soviet collusion, that's on one side, and against the old left, the three varieties of old left, but the old left, all of which were movements, you see, that were, in our language of today, we didn't use it then, were vertical movements. That is to say, they saw that only one movement was allowed to exist per country, and it had to control everything else, and if you weren't part of that, you were sort of anti-revolutionary and so forth. So then it was a kind of structure down from the top down, whether you're dealing with social democratic or communist or national liberation movements. They were the vertical movements, and they said to all these people, and that's the next important theme about 1968, the theme of the forgotten peoples. They all came and said, look, you know, the women have been forgotten. The ethnic groups have been forgotten, black power, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. The people with other sexualities, they've been forgotten. Because the movements had said, yeah, you got something, but you wait till the revolution comes, and we'll solve that problem later. And 68 was all these people saying, there's no later, it's now. And we're legitimate, as legitimate as the claims of the so-called central actors, subjects of history. We're subjects of history too. So this was all this theme of 1968. And 1968 blew up, very powerful everywhere, and then it died out or got repressed, and by about the mid-70s, it was nowhere, okay? Nowhere but everywhere, you see, because it transformed the situation in the world, and that's what's important to see. The revolution undid something very important. And something that was very important that it undid two things. One, it undid the central legitimacy of centrist liberalism. My fourth volume, which we were just talking about, is entitled Centrist Liberalism, and it's about how it emerged in the 19th century as a dominant theme, saying that, yes, everything has to change, but slowly, in controlled ways, rationally, led by sophisticated people who know how to do it, etc. And what they did was they marginalized the conservatives and the radicals on both sides and made them into not clones but avatars, having to accept the legitimacy of this soul path. And 68 exploded that. And it liberated the conservatives, who went back to being real conservatives again. The people you see today as conservatives, they weren't around in the 50s. They were not around. Just take a simple thing. What's his name? I'm trying to think of the major economist, Friedman. Milton Friedman was an academic joke in the 1950s. No one took him seriously. Okay? And by the 1970s, and certainly by the 1980s, he's the legitimating figure of the economics profession. Now that's the transformation. That's the re-legitimation of genuine conservative thought. And there's the re-legitimation of genuine radical thought, which we're experiencing. Okay, so now what happened? The legacy, first of all, the real legacy was both this explosion of the re-legitimation of this, of the right and the left, if you want to call them that. That's one thing. And the second thing was that the whole question of verticalism, right, was open now, reopened for questions. And in the language which we developed only in the 21st century, we talk about horizontalism. That is to say, the whole idea that movements are out there, and they are multiple kinds of movements, and they have to speak to each other, they have to deal with each other, but there is no one on top. They have to cooperate, they have to analyze, and they have to cooperate, and they have to legitimate each other and not denounce each other. And that's this horizontalism that you see very much now in the Occupy movements. Now, so one thing is to see what 68 did, which was to really transform not merely the world system, but the movements. The movements have never been the same before. And the old left movements have just collapsed in their language, right? I don't know if any of you, those of you who are old enough and can remember reading a newspaper put out by an old left movement in the 50s, and reading that same newspaper in the 80s or in 2011, right, is to see a transformation in the language. When they talk about all these movements that they used to deprecate and say had to be, suddenly they're all legitimate. And all these movements are saying, yeah, we agree, we have to transform the issues of gender, we have to deal with ecology, and we have to deal with multiple sexualities, and we have to deal with all these questions that are legitimate now, if you read these newspapers, because they still put out newspapers. And in the 1950s, they would never have given them the time of day, except to denounce them. So it's had its impact. Okay, now, the second thing that we have to put into this picture is how a world, a system works. Look, what we have learned, and we've learned this really very heavily from the people who have been into complexity sciences, is that all systems, from the universe as a whole to subatomic systems to historical social systems, all systems have lives. They are not eternal. They come into existence at some point. You have to explain how they come into existence. They have rules which govern their normal lives. And then they begin by a process which can't be stopped to move further and further and further from equilibrium. And at a certain point, the system moves too far from equilibrium. Nothing can pull it back to an equilibrium. And it bifurcates. And when it bifurcates, you're in structural crisis. And when you're in structural crisis, the only thing you know for sure is that the system can't survive. But there are always, since it's a bifurcation, two possible ways of stabilizing a new system. And these are different. And you can't predict which will win. And that's what we've been in since 1968, since 1970. The capitalist world economy, our modern world system, is in structural crisis. I could go on for some time explaining to you how we got into structural crisis, why we're so far from equilibrium. I think that would take me a long time to develop, but and I don't want to spend too much time on that now. But it makes what happens when you're in structural crisis. First of all, structural crises are not crises of a day, or a year, or even a decade. Right? They last 50, 75 years, and this bifurcation process goes on in this struggle before it clicks. At some point, it tilts definitively, and one or the other of the two times of bifurcation wins out. And I use a language to talk about that. I say one of the alternatives is what I call the spirit of Davos. Not Davos, the spirit of Davos. And the other alternative is the spirit of Porto Alegre. What do I mean by that? Look, what is capitalism as a system in its features? Is it really? It's a system which is hierarchical, which is exploitative, and which is polarizing. Over 500 years of its existence, the difference between people on top and people on the bottom has grown bigger and bigger and bigger in every way. And indeed, now, finally, we're really talking about that. That's the language of the Occupy movements. But we haven't really talked about that very much, but that's a major figure. Now, it isn't the only way. Capitalism is a particular kind of system, works through the market, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It's not the only way you can have a system that's hierarchical, exploitative, and polarizing. There are many other ways. And what the spirit of Davos is looking for, since they know that capitalism can't survive anymore, because it doesn't meet its own needs. Capitalists themselves don't meet their own needs because they can no longer have the accumulation of capital that they need. But they are looking for an alternative. That alternative isn't necessarily better. It might be much worse than what we have now, okay? And then there's the spirit of Porto Alegre. And what is the spirit of Porto Alegre? The spirit of Porto Alegre is to have a movement, is to have a world which is relatively democratic and relatively egalitarian. Don't ask me, what does that exactly look like? Because I don't know what that exactly looks like. And you don't know what that exactly looks like. I always say to people, look, suppose in the year 1500 or 1450 or thereabouts, you were sitting around in an audience like this and you're saying, look, the feudal system in Europe is in structural crisis and we're in a bifurcation. Right? And one possible outcome is a capitalist system. It's not the only possible outcome. But that's the one that actually won out. It's a long story of why it won out, but it doesn't matter. I said, who in that audience in 1450 or 1500 would have been able to describe the institutional structures that have developed over 500 years in a capitalist system to work it out and to manage it? So who, nobody here can work out the institutional parameters of a system. You have a certain thrust that you're trying to create that kind of system, and that's one alternative. Now, One of the important things to see is that capitalism as a system, of course, has always had cyclical rhythms. It's had its ups and downs. It's had moments of expansion of the world economy and contraction of the world economy. It's been a constant thing. Give that various names. I tend to call them contrarian cycles. Other people call them other things. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. The point is, what happens in these things is that every time it moves up, and therefore a little bit away from equilibrium, it gets pulled back to a kind of moving equilibrium, okay? So that means that no matter how much you try during this kind of crisis, I don't like to use the word crisis about these things, this kind of moments of difficulty of the system, no matter how much you try, right, you get pulled back to equilibrium. Look, take the two most famous so-called revolutions in the history of the capitalist world system, the French Revolution and the Russian Revolution. They were efforts of enormous social input. People worked very hard to transform the world as they saw it being transformed. Now, it isn't very hard to demonstrate that what happened with both the French Revolution and the Russian Revolution is that it was pulled back to equilibrium and changed a hell of a lot less than the people intended to change, right? So that's, in that sense, it was a fairly determinist situation in which you put in your effort and 30, 50, 70 years later, you saw that it changed a lot less than you intended. Now, the good news about a structural crisis, the good news is that this gets flipped on its head. What happens in a structural crisis is you have so much fluctuation, so rapid, so constant, so uncertain, right, that nothing pulls it back to equilibrium. And you know what the complexity scientists always talk about, the business of the butterfly effect? How many people here know about the butterfly effect? Okay, well, good, terrific. The butterfly effect is the idea that if a butterfly flaps its wings over here, at the other end of the world, something changes in terms of the climate. So every little butterfly affects that because it's just an input that pushes things further away from equilibrium. So what I like to say is we're all little butterflies. Every moment, at every instant, every nanosecond, every action by every nano person is affecting the outcome. So in that sense, free will has suddenly emerged. We really can change things, but it's only if every one of us are putting every little bit of our efforts everywhere. So let me now come to our present situation, okay? The Occupy movement is sensational. It's sensational for various reasons. One, it spread faster and to more places than one could possibly have imagined, and it's held out. Okay? Secondly, they have maintained the spirit of horizontalism very much and resisted those who have tried to take it over and verticalize it, right? And it's reached out. It's said, we don't want to be a tiny little sect. We want to be more inclusive. Of course, when you try to be more inclusive, then there comes a question of, do you have some coherence? And that's a major problem. So far, it's been a golden moment. The golden moment is not going to last. Not going to last because people are going to start beating people over the heads. There's no question about that in my mind. And we have to see that repression and suppression as a counter movement is going to come all over the place. It has already, of course. You've seen it in the Arab Spring, and you're seeing such attempts in many other places. It will come in the United States too. Now the question is, what then? That is our problem, and that is our issue, right? How do we now think about, organize, work to restructure, renew, and how shall I say, go around the corner when this is blocked over here to go around there? And I have simple answers to that. It is a matter of keeping a balance between being too narrow in terms of who we pull into the movement and too broad. And that's a very, very tricky question. Not easy at all, right? So far, so good, but you know, it's constant work. It's constant work on your part. It's not just on my part, it's on your part. It's on everybody's part. And will things happen in the next 2 years, 4 years, 6 years? No, you've got another 20, 30, 40 years of struggle ahead of you before it clicks, before enough of the butterflies go in this direction rather than in that direction. You don't know who's going to win, right? But you do know that you can affect who's going to win by your actions, by your reality. So, but you've got to think in the long haul, and most of you in the audience are young enough to be able to think 30 or 40 years ahead, because that's what it's going to take, in my view, for us to come out at the end, hopefully, with the spirit of Porto Alegre, with the relatively democratic, relatively egalitarian world system that we've never seen before. It will be a new thing in the history of the world. Right? It's not, there's no model for it. There's no previous. We know all the things that went wrong with attempts to start this. We don't know what's going to go right and how we do it. But we've got to constantly. So let me summarize my view. One is, the most important thing that we can do is to talk to each other and try to analyze the reality of what's going on in the world. That's step number one. And step number two is, we've then got to insist on a moral preference. We want to move this world in one direction and not in the other. And then and only then can we talk about our political tactics. What actual tactical moves can we make to transform the situation in the world? So it's a triple demand. It's an intellectual analytic, a moral judgment, and a political tactical set of decisions that we have to get involved ourselves in. It's not easy, but it's doable, if provided only that you don't assume that history is on your side. That's the last thing I want to say. History is on nobody's side. It's on nobody's side. There's nothing inevitable. We may end up by 2050 in a much better world, but we may end up in 2050 in a worse world, okay? And it's not, no one can say now which of the two will win out. So it's up to us. But you've got to work hard constantly and with, how shall I say, no illusions, no assumptions that Wall Street is gonna collapse the day after tomorrow. But Wall Street is not very, very comfortable about the strength of the Occupy Wall Street movement. I mean, it's no, just take, I think it's almost a minor thing, but take the way Citibank has backed down on this attempt to charge people for their debit cards. I mean, what did happen? What happened was one woman got angry and went on the internet and started a petition. And in no time flat, she got an amazing number of people to sign the petition. And the banks got scared, and they pulled back. And when one bank after another pulled back, and Citibank finally said, we better pull back too. So, you know, that's a sign of their perception of our strength, okay? Will they move in with stronger forces? I don't know, you don't know. They're obviously people biting at the bit to knock people over the heads, and they've done a certain amount of it already, but they've hesitated to do more because of our strength up to now. So I'm going to stop here because I know there'll be comments, and then I know you want to get into questions.